So today I'm going to talk about observing the universes. So I'll talk about sort of maybe a little bit more general things in terms of what we know about our observable universe, how we measure things, what the limitations are, so the practical and the fundamental limitations are on what kind of knowledge we can gather about our universe. And then I'll talk a little bit about this idea and ultimate implementation of testing eternal inflation by looking for the remnants of collisions between bubbles in our own universe, which Anthony mentioned a little bit yesterday, and I've been asked about a few times, so I'll just give you the spiel. Okay, so let's go back to the CMB. Remember that the CMB is kind of a two-dimensional projection of a 3D field. Actually, it's a two-dimensional projection of a four-dimensional field, because all the stuff in between the surface of last scattering where the CMB was created and today can influence the path of photons. So,
and moreover, the surface of last scattering, so-called, isn't infinitely thin.
And the surface of last scattering is not infinitely thin, that's right. So this, you know, this 2D representation of the 3D field, you know, it comes out of the screen a little bit, and the photons seem to pass through that little cloud, and then, you know, subsequently when the universe reionizes, it passes through another big cloud, and you know, you gotta worry about all that. But for all intents and purposes, there exists a map between this field, which is really a four-dimensional field, and what we see on the CMB sky. And as I mentioned in lecture one, the way to think about that is to decompose the temperature fluctuations in the CMB into spherical harmonics. And I have these spherical harmonic coefficients, which are ultimately related through this black box, the transfer function, to the sort of 3D field that I started with. And that's represented here by, say, the gravitational potential on the surface of last scattering. That's what all these lumps and bumps are here. And also in that black box is all the stuff in between last scattering and us today. And you know, the fact that, as Joel mentioned, the surface of last scattering isn't really an instantaneous event. It's got some thickness to it. So all that physics is in that box. Okay, but there's a map. That's the important part. So just to mention one thing, you know, if I just have this projection, I can get tricked. So I don't really know what the actual underlying density fluctuations are, because different realizations can give me the same exact projection. So whenever I just have one two-dimensional representation of this real three-dimensional field, I can get fooled. There are different three-dimensional fields that will give me the same two-dimensional projection. That's just something to keep in the back of your mind. So remember the interesting observable for the CMB, if the underlying density fluctuations are really statistically homogeneous and Gaussian, etc., is the power spectrum. So let's say I gave you the CMB. How, in a perfect world, would you measure the power spectrum? So what you would do is you would decompose it into spherical harmonics, and you would take the spherical harmonic coefficient times its complex conjugate for a given L and sum over all the M modes. So you'll recall, for a given L, for spherical harmonics, there are two L plus one M modes. M goes from negative L to positive L. And zero counts two, so that's why it's plus one. So there's two L plus one M modes. And so those are my data points, right? That's really all I have. And if we look at the error I expect for a given CL, L has, you know, L takes different values, different integer values. For a given L, the error on the power spectrum is just 1 over square root n. So there's an error here, 1 over square root 2L plus 1. So assuming Gaussianity and isotropy basically tells me that CL is all there is.
This is what's not.
This is all the information that there is. Remember, that's a consequence of a Gaussian random field, you know.
Except that when you have a small number, you don't use Gaussian, you use Poisson. Or is it Poisson?
Yes.
Yeah. How do you adjust your choice of basis? Do you do some averaging?
So, what do you mean by that?
Harmonics, you know, like, you're choosing the basis of what the angles are, right?
Hmm.
So you have, like, you know, the simple bows, right? You have, like, 0.0 on top of it. But then you could adjust the rotating things in which way.
It doesn't matter. Pick any basis you want. You just get different you get different values for ALM for different M's, depending on if you rotate it. Does that make sense?
And why ALMs are a complete set of orthogonal functions on the sphere. But if truth be told, they don't actually do this. And of course,
I'll get there.
Matt knows that.
Yeah. I'll
get there. Right. So it's actually the cut sphere.
I'll get there in a second. Yeah. Let me talk about the real world.
Yeah.
Another question?
In all this discussion, are we seeing one hemisphere and a spherical surface, and then we see one and half, or are we seeing the whole thing somehow?
We're seeing the whole thing somehow. I mean, we're seeing the whole thing. So if there was nothing in between us and the CMB, we'd really be seeing a celestial sphere. And it would be uninterrupted, it would all be primordial, that would be the perfect world.
But of course, you're only seeing half the sphere at that illustration.
Sure. So that's just some three-dimensional picture of the sphere. But maybe the three-dimensional rendering didn't come out so well. It's really a ball. If we had a beach ball, we could paint the CMB on it. You can buy those online. And then that's what you see, right? So the point is that if I have a single two-dimensional projection, there are a finite number of data points in principle. Done. Full stop. Okay, so I cannot get better precision than this. And that's something called cosmic variance. So there just are fundamentally a finite number of data points for a given bin in L. Okay, so that's in a perfect world. So even in a perfect world, there's a limitation on how precisely I can know the power spectrum. And we don't live in a perfect world. So here is data from the Planck experiment. So Planck measures the CMB sky at a different set of frequencies. So this is one particular frequency, 143 gigahertz, which happens to be the one where the amplitude of the primordial fluctuations, which are this stuff here, basically, is maximized. See, but there's other crap here. So there's this band through the middle. So who can tell me what that is? That's the galaxy, right? So the galaxy also emits radiation at this frequency, right? It emits radiation at a wide variety of frequencies. And it's this particular frequency where the radiation from the galaxy is sort of minimal compared to the primordial cosmic microwave background radiation. But it's still there, and it's just there. You can't get rid of it. Can't get rid of the galaxy. So in the real world, the first problem that you have in trying to measure the power spectrum is that you need to deal with foregrounds. So there's the galaxy, but there's other stuff in here, like if the CMB passes through some large cluster of galaxies, it's going to get screwed up a little bit. There's point sources that also emit in a variety of frequency ranges. And all of this obscures the primordial signal, which is what we're interested in for cosmology. That being said, there's actually really a ton of very interesting astrophysics that you can do by measuring these foregrounds. For us, they're garbage, but for astrophysicists, there's a huge wealth of information. And I think once Planck runs out of steam doing primordial cosmology, there's actually really a lot of very interesting things you can do with astrophysics. So it's not garbage. But for us, it's garbage today. So what you do, the strategy is, you can measure a whole bunch of different frequencies. So you measure the CMB sky at a variety of frequencies. And the thing about astrophysical sources is that they vary significantly with frequency, while the primordial signal is varying very slowly with frequency. And so you can see that here in this map. You know, look at how important that galactic signature is on these different plots, while the primordial signal roughly stays constant. You can almost see it by eye. And so you can employ a strategy where you basically take a bunch of different maps at different frequencies. And so these plots you see, where you see the whole CMB, are linear combinations of these maps at different frequencies, which have been added in such a way that you subtract off that galactic signal. So you can measure how the galactic signal changes with frequency, and then combine these maps in just the right way that you cancel it off. So I guess the first thing to emphasize, is that this is not like totally accurate, right? So this is just some representation. And there's error in there. So there's error in how you co-add these maps. From a variety of sources, some for practical reasons, like each of these maps have different resolutions just because the size of the window that you're looking through the CMB at changes depending on what instrument, so what frequency you're measuring. And that's one source. And the other source is maybe you just don't get it right. And there's other stuff in here. So you can also clean the map by knowing where, you know, the biggest point sources are. You can clean the map by knowing where the big clusters of the galaxies are in the way and such. And you can do your best to try and get here. An alternative strategy is to figure out where the signal is most contaminated and just cut it out. And that was what Joel was mentioning. So you just take the sky and you stick a mask on to just get rid of all this stuff that you know is a foreground and it's crap, it's not real. Not primordial, excuse me. Okay, so that's a challenge. It's not an insurmountable challenge, but you know, you need to keep that in mind. So we're not in a perfect world. That's one thing you have to do to make these measurements. Another thing that's kind of annoying is that you don't measure the CMB sky totally uniformly. So the satellite, Planck satellite, for example, is spinning. And as it spins, it's measuring different patches of the CMB. And it spends more time looking at certain places than it spends looking at other places. So this is a map you can think of like integrated time it spends looking at different points on the sky. So it spends a lot of time looking around here, and sort of less time looking in here. And that changes depending on my strategy for scanning the sky. So why is that annoying? Because that means that there's actually a source of statistical anisotropy that's built into the way that I do the experiment. So the amount of noise in one place is different than the amount of noise in another place. And so even fundamentally, just by having to do this measurement, the CMB is not exactly statistically isotropic. That means there's a little bit more information in there than just the power spectrum. So you need to be careful about that too.
You mean the information on the actual pointing pattern?
Yeah, so what you need to do is you need to really understand extremely well the scanning strategy of your experiments. You can take this and subtract it off and get the primordial signal. So that, again, that's not an insurmountable obstacle, but the world is not perfect, so there's a little bit of mess in there that you need to contend with. Nevertheless, you know, you can do a pretty darn good job. So here again is the data. This is what they measure. Basically, this is some generalization of just taking a ALM times ALM star and summing over M, dividing by the number of M. And so here are the error bars of the experiment. And the green band, which I don't know if it's entirely visible, that's what you'd expect based on just cosmic variance. So that's at a perfect fault. And so if you compare the size of these error bars to the size of the green band, you're pretty close. It's not exact, but you're really close. So that means that, well, basically, this experiment is precise enough that, as I mentioned last time, it's kind of pointless to try and do it again. Yep?
Can you talk a little bit about cosmic variance? I mean, why, in principle, can you not get any more? I mean, astronomy has been a history of just increasing your resolution. Why would that not buy you anything more?
So you can increase the resolution, that will buy you something. So when you increase the resolution, that's helping you down here. Because you can resolve smaller scales by increasing the resolution. But cosmic variance is worse at the largest scales. So even the first CMV experiments that were done were like almost cosmic variance limited, because the error bar can still be pretty big, but so is this error bar from cosmic variance. So what is cosmic variance? It's really just the fact that I have this 2D map, right? And if I decompose that into spherical harmonics, that is, I ask what are the features of that map at different scales, it's just true that there's not really a lot of information about the map at large scales. There's only a few, a few things that I can learn about that. So
and
statistically,
the number of 90 degree patches, that's the quadrupole, it is basically just 5. That's what's meant by saying fairly equals 2, which just means 5 numbers. And that's all that's measurable. That's all there is. And when that's all you have, it's like flipping a coin 5 times. It's not going to come up equal numbers, heads and tails. It's just statistics.
Yeah.
So no matter how good your experiment, there's nothing. I mean, this is as good as you can get. That's something that Matt was emphasizing yesterday, that there's a limit.
Yeah.
And we're at it.
And we're at it, that's right. So anyway, that's just a few words on, how the real world might work and how it compares to the perfect world and how close we can get to the perfect world. So I think the take-home message is that even though we don't live in a perfect world and there's all this nasty astrophysics, this is quite an achievement that this experiment was built. And it basically reaches the ultimate limit that you can hope for from cosmic variance.
Can you comment a little bit on why the error bars of normal equal or non-symmetric and non-Gaussian?
What do you mean not Gaussian? That I don't get.
It's not. They're not symmetric about the data point. Is this the sum? Is this the answer?
They're big error bars. So.
What do you mean? Why is the positive bigger?
The up error bar and the down error bar are different lengths.
Oh, I see. Thanks. Yeah.
I
think
the reason
it's not the Gaussian variable.
Right. See, A is probably Gaussian, but the square of a Gaussian variable is not Gaussian.
Yeah.
Okay. Because it's CL squared.
Yeah.
Thanks.
CL is the square of omega.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
A lot of these quads
show
CL squared.
This is L squared.
No, this is just CL. CL is ALM squared.
CL, but it's ALM squared. ALM is the value squared.
Okay. Something got it.
And any nonlinear function of a Gaussian variable is not Gaussian. I mean, for example, the square goes from 0 to infinity, whereas a Gaussian variable is positive or negative.
Okay, never thought about it. Thanks. So that's cosmic variance. Now let's think about the thing we're interested in, which is characterizing the actual primordial fluctuations, right? So here's this map again, or this plot, where on the vertical axis we have co-moving scale, and on the horizontal axis we have conformal time. If you have to memorize one graph from all of these three lectures, please memorize this one, because it's really useful and there's a lot of information. So here's inflation. Remember, what is inflation? This line is the co-moving horizon. Inflation is something that decreases the co-moving horizon with time. After inflation, the co-moving horizon grows. Different modes have constant co-moving scale. So, if I ask about the range of scales that we actually measure, so the range of scales that contribute significantly, say, to those ALMs, or the range of scales that we see in large-scale structure, that's a window in K. And these different modes cross the horizon during inflation at different times. And, you know, it's only the modes that well, okay, so what window in time does that correspond to? And the answer is it's roughly 10 e folds of inflation. So we see stuff happening, sort of another thing to learn from this plot, towards the beginning of inflation. So here's the end of inflation, here's the beginning of inflation.
Well, actually, the beginning is probably way, way up there.
Yeah.
But this is the beginning of the part.
I tried to say it carefully.
That's towards, our whole universe.
Towards the beginning of inflation.
That's the visible universe.
That's the visible universe. So inflation might have carried on for much longer. That line could go way up through the ceiling. We wouldn't know. Those scales are too big for us to see. Okay, but this is the range of measured or observable scales today. Okay, so there's a window of 10 e-folds that we actually can probe of inflation. And the other thing is that the largest scales were the ones that were produced the earliest. Okay? So information about the earlier parts of inflation, not necessarily the beginning, is information that's encoded in the largest scales.
Just ask a question about that?
Yeah.
So if the bottom of the kink is the end of inflation, why are we not sensitive to some of the things that happened toward the end of inflation? Like the 10 e-folds, it looks like it's not exactly at the end of inflation.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually 60 e-folds, roughly, from the beginning, the left-hand side mark of the 10 e-folds, to the end.
Sure. So we don't see this, so you want to know about a mode down here?
Yes.
Okay, so that's some really tiny, that's a microphysical scale.
Mm-hmm.
So those fluctuations became nonlinear, did their thing way, 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 way long ago.
You see, they entered the horizon like a few minutes after the Big Bang, or
right.
A year, or a few
right.
years. And so they're now all totally complicated. They've been absorbed into bigger and bigger fluctuations. Nonlinear physics has completely taken over. This is a remark I made yesterday when Matt said this is the only sky we have. And I said, yeah, and you can only probe 4 orders of magnitude. And 4 powers of 10 is 10 e-folds, the same thing.
Right.
And so this is the range of scales, the green strip that correspond to linear modes?
Yeah, so linear and slightly nonlinear. You can do a little bit better than just linear, but not too much better.
So
there should be like two bands here. There's sort of green, there's yellow, which is the sort of nonlinear scales that we sort of know something about, and then there's red, which are the things that are so nonlinear that you can never hope to figure out what's going on.
Mm.
That's like figuring out the weather 10 million years ago based on the weather today. It's just that hard, right?
So if you were thinking of this in a physical space, the horizon would asymptote to a constant physical distance. Is that correct?
No, the physical scale is, well, in if you assume there's a cosmological constant, which we think there is, then yes.
That's what I'm
trying to say. Depends on the assumptions.
So during inflation, you'd have something similar.
Yeah, during inflation, the physical scale of the co-moving horizon is growing, but it's growing very slowly.
Oh, yeah, so it's almost a constant.
Yeah.
And then, so you think about modes of a given size. How do you think about modes leaving the horizon in a physical space picture instead of a co-moving picture?
Well, they start small, they grow. At some point, they reach the size of the horizon, and then they keep growing.
So it's just thinking about modes growing. There's a fixed box, roughly, and they're just
yeah. And by growing, I mean stretching. So don't confuse that with growing amplitude. There's
stretching with cosmic expansion.
Yeah. Okay. So that's just the point that the largest scales are produced earliest. So if we want to learn about stuff happening towards the beginning of inflation, that's encoded in the largest scales. And if I look at these boxes, the transfer function, this thing that maps the 3D field onto my 2D sky, here is that transfer function for L equals 2 in some arbitrary units, don't worry about it too much, as a function of K. So the horizontal axis is K, and this is the window function, okay? So you can see that this peaks at smaller k, right? So that means the low multipoles pick up smaller values of k. They're sensitive to those values of k, but it's a range of k that matter, right? It's an integral. So this is an integral over k. While the higher multiples, here's l equals 5, peak at larger values of k, and they're not as sensitive to these small values of k. So in multipole space, I'm probing the earliest times, aka the largest scales, by looking at the lowest multiples. And that's a property of this window function. I mean, you didn't have to do the maths to really see that. If I have some really long wavelength fluctuation, obviously that's going to map onto a really long wavelength fluctuation on my screen. But that's mathematically how it comes out. So, well, what does that mean? The most intrinsic, that is, caused by cosmic variance uncertainty, is at the largest scales, and therefore closer to the beginning of inflation. So we know more about the sort of heart of inflation, if you will, after it's already, after there's a few e-folds since the scales we can start to probe, than we do about the first few e-folds. And that's an intrinsic limitation if I just have the CMB. That's it. Which is kind of too bad, because we'd really like to know about the beginnings of inflation. And what this is telling you is that it's just hard to probe the beginnings of inflation given just the CMB. It's difficult because of cosmic variance.
Does the transfer function, is it just the way that you construct the map, or does it also implicitly have information about the secondary anisotropies?
Yeah, it's got everything. That's a black box that you just shove all the physics of how you go from when the CMB photons were first released to when they're getting rid of detected. Okay, so you're like, can we do better? Let's not talk about practicality now. Let's just talk in principle. Like, can we do a lot better than that? So the first thing to note, and this might be an obvious point, but I think it pays to just say it, is that we only see what is on our light cone. So right now, we only see things that are on our light cone, for example, we don't see, the actual galaxies that the fluctuations in the CMB grow into. Right? Those are somewhere else. So here's a picture, right? Here's the CMB, here's some galaxies at some later time, and here's today. And if I look at my past light cone, here's the part of the CMB that I see. It's just the line, it's not the inside, right? It's just the line, the intersection of the light cone with that plane. And here's the intersection at some later time. So when I do some galaxy survey, I'm seeing galaxies that are along this ring, and when I look at the CMB, I'm seeing the CMB fluctuations projected onto that ring. And this little lump here turns into that galaxy. Well, that galaxy isn't on my past light cone, so I don't actually see that galaxy. Correspondingly, that galaxy grew from this lump here, and, well, I don't see that lump in the CMB. So that might be obvious, but I think it pays. So the best we do right now, like if we just design in our lifetimes the best possible experiments to probe all of cosmology, the best we can do by staying here on Earth and not waiting a really long time is to get a set of projections at these different times. Okay? And they're related, they're correlated, but they're not like directly related. That is, the lumps and bumps here are not the lumps and bumps here, right? It's not a direct correspondence. And so the best I can do is to get this set of projections and look at the statistics of these fluctuations, right? So they're correlated. That means it's meaningful to look at the statistics. So I can start with some guess for the initial probability distribution and predict what it would look like on these different time slices. That's certainly possible. And so I can get information about the statistics. So with more projections, we can do better. We can better test our theory of the initial conditions and evolution of probability distributions. Okay? So this helps, this certainly helps, because I can now beat down cosmic variance, right? So for each of these independent projections, I now have five modes, say for L equals 2. And so I can do a little bit of a better job of characterizing the probability distribution.
Yeah. Can you jump back to the last slide for a second? So, if we're talking in principle and really, really crazy, if you actually wanted to be able to see the galaxies that CV filter through into, I guess you could coordinate experiments that are like two different observers that are the same distance away as those two points, same moving distance away. They can both do their separate CV observations and then compare them to each other.
We'll talk about that in a second.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Let me just remind you, as I explained with that cosmic series of time picture back on Monday, the galaxies that the CMB fluctuations grew into are now 46 billion light years away.
Pretty far, and possibly unreachable, as we'll talk about in a second, in principle.
So the connection between these different times is purely statistical. We're assuming that the statistics are the same, but of course the actual fluctuations that grew into these different things are completely different. So it's the same power spectrum, I think, that gave rise to everything.
That's right.
And what time scale would it vary?
The entire history of the universe.
Sorry?
The history of the universe.
Yeah, sure, but to see a significant difference, you know. If you just the exact, I guess if you look at the order, it's exactly the same.
Yeah, so if you look at epochs that are too close together, then it will basically look very, very similar, right? So really what you want to do, let me just say real quick, and then this will kind of answer your question or get to it, is that this is hoped to kind of be done by looking at the 21 centimeter emission line or absorption line of hydrogen. That's when you take the electron and it goes from aligned with the proton to the anti-ion, or vice versa. And there's hydrogen everywhere in the universe. Okay, so that means that this is being emitted everywhere in the universe.
Well, neutral hydrogen, but only down to recombination, down to reionization.
That's right, yeah, only down to reionization. And then in some, like, if we build crazy telescopes on the moon, maybe you can hope to go back before that, but that's in the future. So what you can do is you can look at different, hydrogen that emits or absorbs this radiation at different times will have, you know, the redshift will be different depending on the epoch. The redshift of the emitted photons will be different. And so by tuning the frequency that I'm measuring at, I can actually look at different cosmological epochs. That is, I can get a bunch of different celestial spheres and a bunch of different projections. And I can kind of realize this idea.
In what's called the dark ages, before galaxies are built.
Yeah. Or even afterwards. So actually there's a Canadian experiment called CHIME that's currently being built, which is really cool. So what it does is it takes a really low resolution measurement of the intensity of this radiation coming from different parts of the sky. And where is the hydrogen? That's, you know, where the baryons are. So what this experiment hopes to do is by taking a really low resolution picture of all of these different projections is to measure the so-called baryon acoustic oscillations that I talked about before to really get accuracy. And it's not just one projection on one sphere, that's actually a three-dimensional picture of the baryon acoustic oscillations. So, so these experiments are being done. The really fancy ones probably won't be done for a while, but the first ones are being done. So this idea is being realized. And so you just do better, because now you're getting a volume. You're getting a volume from the light cone. You're not just getting one projection. So you do better. And then, as Joel's mentioned a few times, another limitation is, there's just really a finite number of linear modes that you can measure, right? So here's the window, remember, where stuff grows. And if stuff grows too much, well, it becomes nonlinear, and then that's too hard to analyze. And that, you know, if we go along the light cone, is a sort of narrowing window. Because with more time, things have had more time to collapse. So in any given time slice, there's this window of k, sort of the k that I can actually probe by observations, and the k where things have become nonlinear. And that's the window where I can actually make sense of what I see. Okay? And at the time of the CMB, that's a really big window because nothing is nonlinear yet, and I'm just limited by how big of a mode I can probe. But say at a later time, when galaxies start to form, I become limited because now the smaller scales have collapsed into nonlinear structure, and I only have access to things that are really long wavelength. So there's some narrowing window. And if I count up all the stuff that I can measure, as Joel has said, there's something like 10,000 independent linear modes that I can measure. And so that's really, if I just stay here on Earth and design the most precise experiment possible, that's the limit, right? I've got that many data points if I could measure them, and that's the best I could ever know the power spectrum. You know, the primordial one, the one that's a function of k. And that's an intrinsic error bar. That's just there. Okay, so now let's get even more speculative, right, and ask sort of what in principle is my limitation of knowledge? You know, like how much can I really know? So without a fundamental cosmological constant, here is the Penrose diagram for Robertson-Walker universe. So let's say that this is the surface of last scattering, and let's say I can't know anything before this. Well, maybe in some futuristic world where we could measure neutrinos and gravitational waves, I could actually get down farther, but let's just keep that for now. And here I am today, and I'm looking back, and my past light cone hits the surface of last scattering here. And I just see that dot on this diagram. A sphere. So I can just wait. Okay, I can just wait, and now I'll see more of the surface of last scattering. So now I see a volume. Right? So that's depicted by this green thing. That's a volume. That's a set of spheres. And I can wait longer, and I could wait an arbitrarily long time, and then after an arbitrarily long time, I'd actually see an infinite total volume. So this observer, with you know unlimited precision and infinite amount of time to wait, would actually get infinitely precise statistics. So if I wait an infinite amount of time, I could characterize the power spectrum to any degree of precision you like. Also, you know, I could like go anywhere too. So any of these galaxies that I see in my past, I could leave the Earth now, and then, you know, if I wait long enough, I'll get there eventually. And I could come back, and I could report my results to Earth. So this is the really interesting Star Trek. You know, like here is Captain Kirk, and he can go out and observe all these, you know, nice alien races on different galaxies or whatever, and he could come back to Starbase and report his results. All done. So anything that I observe in the past, I can visit, and I can come back. So that's a universe without a cosmological constant. Here's the universe with a cosmological constant. So Anthony drew this diagram yesterday. This is the Penrose diagram for De Sitter space. And so one thing to note is that, so this is future null infinity, that is any null ray will end up here, okay? This is called future time-like infinity, that is any time-like observer will end up at that dot up there. And De Sitter space is markedly different because future null infinity is this line, so all null rays in there. And future time-like infinity is also that line. So time-like observers will end up at different spots up here. And so the causal structure of De Sitter space is way, way different than the causal structure of a Robertson-Walker universe in important ways. So here is the surface of last scattering on this conformal diagram. And I could try and do the same thing. So here I am today, I look back, and I could wait a really long time. But even if I wait an infinite amount of time, I'm only going to see a finite volume on the surface of last scattering. And that's because De Sitter space has event horizons. So I'm just limited. I can't see farther than outside the event horizon. Ever. I can wait an infinite amount of time, and I wouldn't see anything else. So that means that I can only characterize the statistics of the power spectrum here with finite precision. And that's a really fundamental intrinsic limitation. I cannot measure things more precisely. And I can go some places and come back. So here's some galaxy, and here's Starship Enterprise. I see the galaxy, and then I can go there and come back and report my results. But if the galaxy is too far away, then I can't. you know, here I see it, and then as soon as I see it, I leave the Earth and I try and reach it, but I never get there. So these galaxies that we see in the CMB, you know, the lumps and bumps that we see in the CMB, most of them correspond to galaxies today that I'll never be able to reach if there really is a fundamental cosmological constant. They're just gone. I'll never get there. So that's the limitation when I have a cosmological constant. Now we can think a little bit more deeply about what are the other limitations on knowledge. So there's an intrinsic fundamental limitation on knowledge in a universe with a cosmological constant. That's one way of seeing it. There's other ways of seeing it. So another way of seeing it is to ask, well, what is, you know, like, forget about the CMB, but I can just do any experiment I want, anything. What are the limitations? Okay, so usually we like to separate things. So, you know, if I'm trying to do a really precise experiment, I don't want to take a really strong magnet and stick it next to my experiment, because that's probably going to screw it up. So I want to put my experiment really far away from any kind of strong magnets. I want to isolate it. I want an isolated system so that I can make an accurate measurement. Well, too bad, because you can't separate things to arbitrary distance in de Sitter space. If I put them too far away, then they're going to be outside of each other's horizon, and I'll never get to know the answer for the experiment. So if these are charges, you know, there's some long-range electric force between them. And I can't make that go to zero by putting these arbitrarily far apart. There's a gravitational force between them. I can't make that go to zero by putting them really far apart. And that's an intrinsic limitation on the precision of any experiment I could ever hope to do. I can never get rid of all the environmental effects. I can never really isolate my system. And again, you know, like, this is all in principle stuff. So don't worry about, you know, like, measuring stuff in the lab on Earth. It's isolated enough, but we're talking in principle. And the other limitation is that you can't make an arbitrarily large or complicated apparatus to do your measurement in the first place. And here's the reason. So here's the horizon, the cosmological horizon. And I'm some super advanced alien civilization, and I can make some extremely complicated large apparatus. So I collect, you know, a billion stars and put them in one place and assemble them in the right way, and I make this this mass. Okay? Now the thing about cosmological horizons is that they shrink in the presence of a mass. So by building this really complicated apparatus, okay, it's, you know, I'm taking a bunch of stuff spread out and concentrating it. I have to admit I don't know exactly how the evolution of the cosmological horizon would look if I did that, but let's just say it shrinks in this way. So the cosmological horizon shrinks in the presence of a mass. So if I make a little bit of bigger, more complicated apparatus to measure something with more precision, it's going to shrink even more. And, well, eventually I'll get to the point where I build my apparatus, the cosmological horizon shrinks, and eventually it'll be on top of my apparatus. And then what can I do? I can make my apparatus a little bit more compact. Okay, but eventually I'll get to the point where the event horizon, you know, I make something that's just almost a black hole, and the event horizon of that black hole is basically sitting on top of the cosmological horizon. And that's the limitation. That right there is the limitation. There is the biggest, most complicated apparatus that I can fit into de Sitter space. And if I try and make a bigger, more complicated apparatus, then, well, basically I'll just make a black hole that eats up the whole universe. And you're done. So that you cannot make arbitrarily large or complicated apparati, and so you can't make an arbitrarily precise measurement.
Sorry, can I ask a quick question?
So yeah.
Are you talking about something like Schwarzschild de Sitter space or something?
Yeah, that's right. So that's
mass in de Sitter, so you're talking about a black hole embedded in de Sitter.
That's right. Yeah. So that's a Schwarzschild de Sitter. Yeah. Anthony?
I mean, if you let the horizon get that big, isn't it kind of too late? I'm a little confused about your setup, because, you know, if you've got the Sitter space, to then get some mass into it, you sort of can't do, right? Because that would be shrinking the horizon, that would be lowering the entropy.
Yeah, so that's what I was saying in the beginning about collecting a bunch of mass and trying to put it together.
So you have to do it before the horizon gets that big.
Right. So we kind of already have to be there, I guess.
You can't literally shrink the horizon. You have to keep the horizon narrow.
Well, yeah, that's right. So I guess there is a limit on the size and complexity of an apparatus that already exists. Maybe that's a better way of putting it. But one cannot exist. Why don't I just say it that way? Yeah, Joel?
I think Lenny, in his talk tomorrow, is going to explain that information is encoded on the horizon,
right.
An event horizon, not a particle horizon. And so, given a cosmological constant, we know the size of the horizon, and we know, therefore, the total amount of information.
Right. That's another way of putting this. So,
which I think is more general.
Yeah, that's another way of putting this.
It's actually very large. It's 10 to the 120.
Oh, it's enormously large. Yeah, we're talking in principle, though, so.
Right. The point is it's not infinite. The
point is it's not infinite, that's right.
Yeah. I mean, isn't more easier limitation the stuff that's a finite amount of stuff in the universe? Not so limited to far before you could ever...
No, I don't think so. There might be an infinite amount of stuff in the universe. I just can't access it all.
A finite amount of stuff in your own cosmological horizon.
Yeah, that would be another way of putting it. There's only a finite number of things that I can gather and assemble into my apparatus. That's another way of thinking about it. So another thing is that another maybe restatement of the same thing that I just said, well, it's related anyways, is that any detector that I build is also constantly being bombarded by the Hawking radiation from this event horizon. So there's no such thing as zero temperature. I can't cool things down to an arbitrarily low temperature. There's an intrinsic jitter due to the Hawking radiation. And so I can't know things more precisely than the temperature of the Hawking radiation. Which in our universe, again, don't worry about it, because that's a really, really incredibly tiny temperature. So you don't have to worry about it too much. But a sort of related point is that any detector has a finite lifetime. So if I wait long enough, eventually I'll be unlucky and the Hawking radiation, there will be some incredibly improbable emission of Hawking radiation that just fries me and my detector dies, and then I can't make my measurement. And that takes a really long time, but it takes a finite time. And that's related to the fact that we think in de Sitter space, with a number of assumptions, like it's a closed system and I believe in ergodic evolution, et cetera, has Poincaré recurrences. That is, if I wait a long enough time, anything that can happen will happen, and it will happen an infinite number of times. Is that a good place to say? Okay, so those are some words on the fundamental limitations on knowledge that exists when I have a cosmological constant. And if we live in a universe with a cosmological constant, these are the true, not practical, but fundamental limitations of what we can know.
Just a question about the last thing about recurrence. In the ways that I'm familiar with proving the recurrence theorem, the system needs to, it's not just that the system is isolated and energetically closed, but it needs to be confined to a finite region of phase space.
Yeah, so you need a finite
dimension. Is there an analog of that here?
Yeah, so one set of ideas, which are just ideas, would be that I can interpret the fixed entropy of this de Sitter space as a statement about the total number of states. Okay. So the entropy equals log n. You take it literally, and n is really the number of states. And in that case, you have a finite
number of states you can cycle through.
Right, exactly.
Ergodically cycle through. So that has the effect of, the same effect as confining it to a finite region. But
Lenny actually is co-author of a paper that proved the quantum Poincaré recurrence theorem. And various people have proved it. So but the point is that there's a quantum analog.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Jumping back just to the idea of what would it take in an in-principle experiment to observe the sort of time history of a given galaxy at a given coordinate position? So I can definitely see that, as Bill pointed out, the CMB is roughly 46 billion light years away, so that...
The material that radiated it is now.
Sure, the galaxies that then became, at that time, distance. So the current redshift of the event horizon is about 1.8. So if you take the Kimberly distance to that, I guess in principle you could have observers separated by that amount that could get each, they could each have different past light films, and they could get different sort of slices of the time history of the galaxy and compare that to each other. Is that something that is in the bounds of this in principle process?
Yeah, sure. So, you know, anything in that gray area, in principle, I can observe and can communicate with me. So I could be a robot at the bottom part of that triangle. You know, I could send a robot out from the Earth from the bottom part of that triangle, and he could measure all the stuff happening over here, and then he could come back and report the results. But if it goes outside that gray triangle, then he can't. That's the causal patch. Okay, so we just went off into screwy theory land where these are the in principle limitations. So let's come back to Earth for a second, and then we'll go back out to screwy theories then. So how do we compare data with theory? Just one slide on that. So we start with our model. Okay, so here was our model, lambda CDM. It's got those six parameters. We shove it into this box that calculates that transfer function for us. And then, with some understanding of the experimental details, we make a prediction for the experiment. Okay, so that's the green line, solid green line. And then by doing this a whole bunch of times, well, so we do that, and then we calculate the likelihood, which is the probability of the data given the model with those parameters. And we evaluate this for different parameters. And we pick out the one that has the largest likelihood. And then we do it, you know, basically we do this until we find that. And we do that just by doing, technically we do these Monte Carlo Markov chains, which means we just search around in this parameter space, and there's some algorithm that tells me how to go in the direction of maximum probability. And then we find that place. And the detailed shape of this likelihood function is what gives us those contours that we always see. Or these error bars, equivalently. And there's a very important other part, which I haven't said anything about, which is that you can include other data sets, right? So you can correlate large-scale structure with CMB, and that helps a lot because it turns out that just with the CMB, and this has changed with Planck because they can measure lensing, there's a lot of degeneracies. Like if I change one parameter, I can compensate for that change by adjusting another one. So including other data sets is really important. And that's kind of schematically how it goes. Okay, so these error bars and those predictions come from that. So we can, you know, also we can include more variables and test the fit. So we can ask, you know, are there tensors? Does the spectral index change with scale? And you do the same thing. You try out a whole bunch of different parameters, and you evaluate this likelihood, and you get these contours. But the punchline, at least for everything that we know today, from Planck and other experiments, is that this six-parameter model still works the best. So that's pretty much all I wanted to say about the CMB, cosmology, in principle possible observations. So any questions on that before we go back into screwy theorist land and I talk about versions of bubble universes?
Okay, back to slide about the, you know, not just the most complicated apparatus, because there's something I don't get about it. If you think about the biggest black hole that we built in from the universe, that corresponds to the maximum entropy, right? Possible. Yes. Even so it doesn't.
No, actually, that's I don't think that's true. I think it's actually a lower entropy state.
If I collect all the matter in the universe in one single black hole, isn't that the maximum entropy state?
No, because then that black hole is going to evaporate and I'm going to come back to the universe with just a Poisson constant and nothing else. So I think that's the highest entropy state.
Okay, before that, okay. Okay, so
are you asking how much
I wonder if this is the best possible arrangement of the matter you have in the universe that gives you, you know, the most clever apparatus. It doesn't. It seems a very, you know, a very specific state where you're losing a lot of information.
Not the most clever apparatus. Just, you know, I'm assuming that, you know, said differently, maybe let's make it a little bit more abstract. You know, let's say I want to, this comes back to some of the comments that Lenny was making, let's say I want to probe some tiny little distance scale. So I want to send in a whole bunch of energy. To probe smaller things in general, I have to send in more energy. And there's a limit on how much energy I can send in from the past and not do that, not make a black hole that's just going to heat up the entire universe. I don't know, maybe another way of saying it is that the black hole has, we think, some huge, you know, huge degenerate number of, or very, very tightly spaced number of states. So if I want a really accurate pointer, I want something that's got a lot of little ticks that it can point to, right? So it's got a lot of energy levels. So the thing that I can make that has the densest spacing of states, you can think is probably something kind of like a black hole. So the bigger the black hole, the denser the states. And so I keep making bigger and bigger black holes to make more and more accurate, or something like a black hole to make more and more accurate pointers. And then there's just a limitation on how tightly spaced I can make states. Yeah?
Can I ask you to expand a little more on this? On this issue, and I know Lenny is probably going to talk about this tomorrow, but maybe it's good to hear. It's always good to hear things for us. About just very crudely, what the structure of the arguments is that link, say, something like the surface area of a black hole to the number of distinct quantum states that it could have. So, if it's just, for example, here's an example which would be worth maybe distinguishing from the black hole case. Take an infinite square well in first quantized quantum mechanics. There are an infinite number of distinct energy states associated with a particle in a square well like that. So there certainly isn't any general principle like if the system is confined to some finite volume, that'll put some limit on the number of orthogonal states that it could be in. So that's not the right way to think about it. What's the right way to think about it?
The only right way to think about it, which may or may not be right, is in the context of string theory, where we can kind of know what the microstates are and specifically count them. So
you mean, these famous theorems relating, you know, say, surface area of a black hole to its entropy?
They don't care about that. That's a thermodynamic statement, so I don't need to know what the microstates are to do that, right?
But we think of the maximum entropy as some kind of a count of the microstates compatible with the macrostate. Yeah.
No, I think that calculation, basically, you by analogy say there's a temperature and there's something, you know, something that's like related to entropy.
So the business of actually counting the states depends on string theory.
Yeah.
I see.
You need to know what the fundamental degrees of freedom are to count the states.
Right.
And the only context in which we think we know how to do that is in the context of string theory.
I see. Okay.
You have to combine gravity with quantum mechanics.
Yeah, that's right.
But you do get the thermodynamic result. That's the amazing thing.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Good.
Well, let's say you tried to say how much mass would a black hole need for it to be the current size of the sun that we're having today? Would you conclude that you need a little bit more mass than we actually have access to? And is that related to your answer to the question a couple of questions ago?
I've never done the computation. It's probably more mass than there is in the universe, I would guess.
So that's another way of saying why the biggest black hole we can make actually wouldn't be the highest entropy state we possibly have, which would be filling the cosmic event horizon with a big black hole.
It's probably related. I don't know what's left, right? But it's related.
But if you throw a black hole in the middle of the center space, it lowers the entropy, right?
Yeah, that's right.
But it increases the horizon.
What's that?
Because it increases the radius of the horizon.
That's right. And even if you include the entropy associated with the black hole event horizon, it still decreases the total entropy.
This question might be too long, but on David Otter's point, so does string theory change that aspect of quantum mechanics where there are an infinite number of energy eigenstates and an infinite square well? So I mean, I would have thought if the string was sort of small and you ignore the internal degrees of freedom, you would still have something like all of those energy states arbitrarily high. Are you saying that goes away?
So I don't know. I mean, I can tell you the what you're counting in the specific example. So we only know how to count in these very specific examples. So what you do is you take, so you turn gravity off, first of all. And now the fundamental objects you have to work with are things like strings and D-brains and things like that. Those are the fundamental objects of string theory. And so what you do is you take a bunch of D-brains, which have charges, and you combine them in just the right way. Well, you combine them in some way, so that you get some compact collection of these D-brains, okay? And now you can count the number of ways to arrange those D-brains that keeps the total charge fixed, say. And that's some set of microstates that correspond to a macrostate that's labeled by a charge. And now
I take it you mean total number of orthogonal ways. Not total number of ways.
Yeah.
Okay, good, good.
So there's a finite number of microstates. There really are a finite number of ways of doing that arrangement. Don't ask me about the details because I don't understand that one. Now you turn gravity back on. Now there's a black hole that has the same charge as that collection of D-brains. And I ask, what is the entropy defined by the area formula? And what is the entropy defined by log n? And they agree. So that's sort of how it goes. But that's a really specific example where I could identify what I think are the real microstates of that object. Like generally speaking, I don't think anyone knows what the real, you know, how to really do the counting in a general case. It's just these really specific cases that we kind of have to do. So I have no idea what it means for the infinite square well or anything like that.
But surely it's not an infinite square well if you're in the sitter space because you have a finite volume available. So it's a finite square well. Moreover, you have a finite maximum energy available because otherwise you'll make a black hole.
An infinite square well is a finite volume of space. The infinity refers to the potential.
Yes, but you don't have an infinite amount of energy available either, because then you'll make a black hole that will decrease the size.
I see.
So you're really trapped. You can't do what you want to do. And you can count the number of states available. I haven't done it, but it's an interesting calculation that's, you know, just a back of the envelope calculation. And it can't be more than the amount of energy, the amount of information that's available on the surface.
Right.
That's an absolute upper limit. It might be that that's a way of reaching it.
The scaling's wrong, so you need,
yeah, the scaling's
you really need
wrong.
Black
it won't work.
Yeah, you really need black holes.
Yeah.
That's the only way you do it.
Yeah, I know. Because otherwise you aren't going to get the R squared.
Any other questions before we move on from these issues to something totally different?
Yeah, there'll be lots more of this, I'm sure, with Lenny's talk, and then also Fred Adams is going to revisit many of these things.
Okay, eternal inflation. So here's the movie that Anthony showed. So we want to know, you know, is this crazy story really our universe? And I think it sort of pays to reflect on how crazy this story is before we go there. So eternal inflation predicts an infinite number of individually infinite universes in an infinite expanding background if I wait long enough. I mean, really? That sounds pretty crazy to me, as a physicist. But as Anthony mentioned, you know, eternal inflation. We don't just come up with this out of the blue. Like, there are good reasons that we're pushed to think about this. Because eternal inflation is seemingly a direct consequence of three things. So the first thing you need is different vacuum states. So those bubbles need to be filled with different things with different properties. So those inside of these bubbles need to have different properties. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a bubble between different regions, right? So where is that in physics that we know? It's common. It's possible in the standard model. I talked about that yesterday when I mentioned that if there's no physics between TV and the Planck scale, then there's actually a more stable vacuum that the standard model has. So there are possibly multiple vacua in the standard model. It's common in beyond standard model physics, so things like the minimally supersymmetric standard model, grand unified theories. All of these theories seem to have non-unique vacuum states. And the reason is, the reason this comes up is that a non-unique vacuum state is kind of related to the idea of spontaneous symmetry breaking. There's not really a one-to-one correspondence, but they're related. And spontaneous symmetry breaking is, that's the Higgs mechanism that's, goes into thinking about grand unified theories. And this is kind of one of the cornerstones of modern theoretical particle physics. It's really important. And non-unique vacuum states are seemingly inevitable in string theory. I mentioned that the other day, because in string theory we need to hide these extra dimensions, and the way to do that is make them small, and there's just tons of ways to make them small, and each way corresponds to a slightly different four-dimensional physics. So it's seemingly inevitable, I would say, in string theory. Okay, the other ingredient we need is quantum field theory. Okay, that's an easy one. We kind of know that works. So Anthony talked yesterday about the way that you make these bubbles. That's just a calculation in quantum field theory, using methods that we think we know, love, and understand. And the third thing we need is a cosmological constant, or even more generally, I think, accelerated expansion. So that's something we observe, right, dark energy, and it's something that we infer that happened in the early universe, inflation. So these three ingredients, just one second. So with these three ingredients, I claim I will generically get the term of inflation. Not always, but sort of as a generic consequence. Question?
So when you say a non-unique vacuum state, is that kind of a single physics that has multiple vacuum states, or is it like the possibility of multiple physics each carrying its own perhaps unique vacuum state?
So really I need some way to connect things, right? So when I say that, I guess implicitly what I'm thinking in my mind is something like these double well potentials that Anthony drew yesterday, where there's really a scalar field, so some order parameter that I can continuously deform that will take me from one place to the other. If these were really disconnected islands, then I don't know that I can get this. So that's more speculative. So let's keep it in the realm of things we think we understand. So like scalar field theories with multiple minima. So that would mean things like, some generalization of the Higgs mechanism, or, in string theory, these would be the different parameters that tell me about the shape and size of the compact space.
So your answer to him was the second one that he mentioned. That is, that there's a single universal theory of which you're discovering solutions that correspond to the infinite, the eternal inflation.
Yep.
Right.
So it's only the different bits of the string theory landscape on this picture would be kind of all part of one physical theory, but I don't know, that apply differently in different regions or something.
So it's an active topic of research whether or not the different places in the string theory landscape can really be connected through these, say, Coleman de Lucca vacuum bubbles. We think so.
But you're not talking about different physical laws.
What do you mean by different physical laws?
Like different fundamental equations.
I might be. I mean, if I can get different fundamental physical laws from the same ultraviolet complete theory, then...
Yeah, but this point is important to get it straight. The different physical laws that you're talking about are different effective Hamiltonians.
Yep.
That you think you can, that you think in principle are all being derived from one Hamiltonian, which is the Hamiltonian in which you're solving for the rolling down the potential, the degree and of the scalar theory and so on and so forth.
Yep,
that's right. Yeah, so these are different fundamental constants, but not something like effective r to the minus 3 gravity or r to the minus 4 gravity. So
No, they could be. Yeah, you could do this.
Yeah, those could be effective. Those could be effective Hamiltonians.
The force law in gravity is just a reflection of the number of dimensions. And yeah, you could have different number of dimensions.
Right.
As long as it's not more than 9.
So there's rules. You know, you can't get everything, but lots of stuff. And
I guess I'm saying, like, you couldn't have, you know, a 15th order partial differential equation governing your wisdom motion, for example.
That wouldn't be a good theory, because they're probably.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
So you only need a different local minimum of the energy, or this is not a statement about the global minimum.
No, you just need local metastable states. That works.
Here's a related question. I mean, we're eventually going to be talking about the possibilities of bubbles colliding, and we're talking about some Earth view of the situation in which we see all these things nucleating and so on and so forth. So I take it geometrically, that means we're also envisioning some background, I mean, it may be dynamical also, but some background geometry in which we can make claims about things like spatial and temporal relations between these different bubbles and so on and so forth.
Yep.
Is that right?
Yep. So it's just like that diagram that Anthony drew with all the
right.
dots on the box.
Right, right.
So
good.
You say that really exists.
Right.
And we are somewhere in that mess.
Right.
And
there's a fact about, you know, in some kind of geometry, the distance between the edges of two bubbles, and what you mean by them colliding is that distance going to zero, and so on and so forth. Good.
Yep.
Okay. Good.
That doesn't hold for all stories. Sorry, that doesn't hold for all stories. Tunneling in a background space time.
Yeah, so there's this good hard working, and that I just don't know what to say about that. So let's just strike those. Let's say that those don't happen.
Right.
Maybe they do, but right. For this story, it's not going to be important.
So, could you say a little bit more about what you mean when you say how generically?
So by that, so why? Okay, so generically, I think there is some way to go between vacuum states by deforming something. Okay, so that might be potential energy. It might be like even as radical as changing topology or something like that. But there is a way. Okay. Okay, so that's one thing that I claim is generic. When I say generic, that's what I mean. Okay, here, what do I mean by generic? So the quantum field theory part, the part that's important, is the rate at which you form these bubbles. Now, the rate at which you form bubbles is, I claim, generically slow. The reason is that this is quantum tunneling, and quantum tunneling is typically an exponentially suppressed thing, unless the energy levels are really close together. So bubbles form very slowly, generically. Not always, but let's just say generically. And that rate is generically much slower than inverse Hubble, the characteristic time scale of accelerated expansion. And whenever you have those three things, you get eternal inflation.
So I thought there was more to say because that sounds like you're saying both generic given potential of a certain sort.
Right, but
so can you say it's generic in a larger sense than that?
So I mean, I could. Well, it requires large hierarchies and things like that. So you know, it's sort of generic in that sense. I don't want orders of magnitude disparity between all sorts of different scales in the problem. Then I'll get it. On the other hand, those are kind of there anyways. It's a cosmological constant problem. So, you know, of course, whenever anyone says the word generic, put on your bullshit detector and probe it. So, I don't know. But that's what I mean by generic. Those are my biases. Yes? Okay. So, there's strong, I would argue, you know, this is strong theoretical motivation. It seems to be something that is bound to happen if I give you some random theory. Maybe that theory is not generic by your definition or my definition, whatever. But it happens, right? And it happens enough that for the same reason we like to think about supersymmetry as a resolution to the hierarchy problem, because that seems weird, you know, we want some explanation. So we should take this seriously in the same way. And so we want to know, you know, this is a crazy idea. There's infinities everywhere. Is this thing, you know, like, can I ever know if this is right or not? Is it experimentally verifiable? And the key to answering that question is to ask, well, is to notice, well, you know, in this mess of eternal inflation, here's our bubble, but, you know, there's other bubbles too. And there's some probability that those other bubbles will collide with ours. And that collision is a possible observational test of this idea of eternal inflation. So here's a sort of big picture of how this would go. So we have, you know, on the top, there's some scalar field potential, say, that's my theory. And that theory gives rise to this eternal inflation picture. And somewhere in that eternal inflation picture, I have some bubble with an open universe that we live in, and then bubbles collide with ours. And then there's going to be some aftermath, some signature of that, right? So that's the chain of causation. You know, I start from the theory, and then I end up all the way at the end, after all this, with some prediction. And of course, the interesting part is that I can run this in reverse. I can ask, you know, is there anything here? Is there any evidence for this going on? And then I can run that whole thing backwards and ask about how this constrains the ultimate theory, you know, these potentials there. And here's just some, you know, boxes that list the types of questions that you might be interested in this chain of causation, a lot of that Anthony talked about yesterday. We won't go into that in detail, but that's the sort of big picture. So we need to understand each kink in this chain. And so Anthony talked a bit about this part here, understanding this picture, the big picture of eternal inflation. He also talked a little bit about this, so let me just expand on that. Okay, so that's supposed to be our universe, right? So here's some bubble, and inside this light cone is an open Robertson-Walker universe. And, you know, you can think that this is like the Big Bang for us. That's where the scale factor goes to zero. So that's the definition of what is the Big Bang. It's not some hot singularity. Here it's actually really cold and devoid of anything. This is totally, there's nothing happening on this surface at all. It's just constant density. That density is finite. It's just a coordinate singularity in this case.
Is that the beginning of inflation or not necessarily?
So first you have curvature domination because it's an open universe, and then you get inflation. So the history of the universe is curvature domination, slow roll inflation, inflation ends, you get cosmology, and then here we are today. And you can do that. You can build a model of the universe that fits inside the bubble and agrees with everything we see today. That's incidentally called open inflation. And this was really popular in the 90s because we thought the universe was open. Empirically, we thought it was open. We were wrong. So people wanted to come up with natural ways to make an open universe. And this was one way.
Can you get inflation starting inside of a closed universe?
Oh yeah, totally. You can have inflation starting inside a closed universe.
So a side question to that is, after inflation, the universe gets very fat.
Right.
Do you have any, how can I put this? Do you have any residual non-flatness left from the previous open state?
It depends on how much inflation there is after the bubble forms.
Right.
And we'll see that actually is key, because one of the things that we're going to require for this to be even in principle observable is that you don't have too much inflation.
Okay.
Because that's going to wipe everything out. Well, actually, let's talk about that now. So here's some other bubble that comes along and it smacks into us. So, you know, we want to know what happens, but the first thing I want you to notice is that any bubble I can conceive of that collides with us collided with us before the Big Bang, right? What we call the Big Bang. It is a pre-Big Bang effect. That is, it is an effect that happens in the very, very early universe. And so you can already guess that this is going to be kind of difficult, right? Because I told you in the first half of my talk that stuff that happens at the towards the beginning of inflation is much harder to probe than things that happen later in time, right? So that's one comment that you should keep in mind. I think that part is really confusing. It was to me for a while, but keep that in mind, please. So collisions are always in our past. It's not like another bubble will come and collide with us now. It's always something that happened in our past, period. And the outcome is not some random thing, it's actually fixed by the theory. So if I know the underlying theory, that is, if I know in the scale of fields the potential, and I know the kinematics, so I know in some sort of center of mass frame how far apart these things are when they form, then I can know everything I need to know. It's totally predictable, but it's hard. To study what happens, you really kind of need full general relativity. And you can guess at what the answer is, and you can do a few analytic things, but it's hard because, you know, you want to find this cosmology, right? So think GR is cosmology. And that cosmology comes out of this sort of highly nonlinear process. Right? So even this bubble is really some solution to the coupled Einstein and field equations that really requires nonlinearity. So that's in there. You know, there's a potentially huge center of mass energy in this collision, so you might want to know, well, do you make black holes or something else? Is there some really important part of this geometry that depends on the energy? And, so as I said, the potential is nonlinear, the field equations are nonlinear, so predicting the outcome up there is, in general, you know, difficult.
So I just want to... I'm sorry to keep slowing me down. When we play at least the standard simple game that you've been playing about telling, about spinning out scenarios like this with just a simple scalar field with a potential that has a couple of minima, or even in the quantum case where it vibrates a little bit, we're imagining, what we're talking about when we talk about these multiple bubbles colliding and so on and so forth, are solutions with the stress energy tensor that we get from that scalar field to the classical Einstein equation.
Yeah.
So there's a universal geometry here. I take it may be topologically non-trivial, or maybe not.
It's trivial to call. Topologically, it's trivial.
I see. So okay. So this is a single. There's a single geometry here. That geometry is a solution to the classical Einstein equations with a stress energy tensor coming from this scalar field. Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay, so if you really want to know what happens, and there's been a lot of work on approximations and analytics, you kind of have to do simulations. And now I can also show you cool movies of simulations, so that's another reason for this motivation. So you can do that. You can do that in full general relativity. It turns out that for two bubbles, there's a lot of symmetry. So you only need one space and one time dimension to reconstruct everything that happens. Something that's happening in 3+1 dimensions, but you only need one space and one time dimension. So okay, let's say I have some scalar field potential. And these look really weird, and this should bother you, because what I'm showing you is sort of what it takes for a single field to make something that you can actually see. So here's some false vacuum, and let's say there's two other types of vacua that I can get to, one of which has this slow roll epoch. Okay, so this is the full scalar field potential. And notice that this interesting part here with the false vacuum and the potential barriers is squashed into this tiny little piece of the graph. So to get something out of this single field model, you need these huge hierarchies in scale between the width of this potential and the length of this path. And that's just the price of entry, and it's totally bothersome and terrible, but Max will tell you how to write down potentials that have multiple fields that look much more natural than this, so don't think that this is a complete obstacle to making something happen. It's just kind of if it's the simplest thing I can write down, but it's the easiest thing to simulate. Okay, so what happens? Let's say I try and collide two identical bubbles. Here's some movie of a computer simulation of that happening. So here are the bubbles, they come together, they collide, and the field sort of gets displaced. And it turns out that that displacement obeys a really simple rule, at least at first. So if we play it again, sorry, those potential, the, these bubbles come in, and these field profiles just actually totally linearly superpose in the beginning. So whenever you have relativistic bubble collisions, it turns out that that's the rule. And we never would have learned that without actually doing the simulation. So that's a nonlinear thing. Well, ironically, it's a linear thing that comes from a nonlinear thing. Okay, and then if I wait long enough, inflation is happening, so this profile just kind of freezes in, just like the inflationary fluctuations freeze in. You can collide different bubbles, and so now I'm just being gratuitous and showing you cool movies. So here are these bubbles, they come in, they collide. Here I'm zooming in on one part. So what happens? Well, they collide, and now there's this wall in between the two bubbles. And that wall oscillates, and it sends out these perturbations to the interior of, say, that's our bubble. And nothing that dramatic happened. Like, I didn't just totally end inflation or totally screw up the cosmology. I just perturbed it a little bit. So that's kind of hopeful, because maybe that looks something like our universe. So these bubble collisions can just perturb this epoch of inflation inside our bubble. So here's a space-time diagram of that movie. So you collide, and then you send out some stuff. You know, I can also look at that in one of these constant time slices, and it looks something like that. And then inflation happens. So remember, this is a pre-Big Bang thing. So these perturbations are laid down at the beginning of inflation, and so they get stretched out a lot. And what that means is you get something really simple at the end of inflation. If this is that Newtonian potential we've been talking about, or the script R, the co-moving curvature perturbation, the universe gets split into these two parts, one that's unperturbed, that's like this part over here, and one part that gets perturbed. But that perturbed part looks really simple, because it's just some function that gets really stretched out. So Taylor expanded, the first thing you get is a linear function. And that's it, basically.
So you have this curvature-dominated epoch before inflation begins, and that's the time when the bubble collisions happen?
No, the bubble collision happens before. That happens before what we call the Big Bang.
That's what I'm saying. So, but are you saying the bubble collision happens during the inflationary epoch, or even before that?
No, before that. There's different time foliations, right? So, the thing that we call cosmology is all the stuff that fits in that light cone. Okay, and time equals zero for us is that light cone. Now, there's another foliation of space-time into space and time, which would be like this is constant. So you can say the collision happened at that time in this foliation. But in this foliation, the collision is just always there. It's just some perturbation of the time we call the Big Bang, right? Some perturbation of that's already there at that time. So the collision doesn't happen at some time in the Robertson-Walker coordinates. It's just always there.
Okay, so there's no unique global time slicing that'll identify exactly when that collision happened.
Yeah, there is. It's this one.
So it's...
But that's irrelevant for cosmology. That time slicing doesn't correspond to what we would call...
This corresponds to our internal proper time, or
right.
Even our internal conformal time.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I mean.
Okay, so that means that this perturbation will split the surface of last scattering into two pieces, one of which has this part that's affected by the collision and another part that doesn't. And if we're lucky enough to be looking at the surface of last scattering and we see one of these boundaries, then there's a detectable effect. So here's a picture. This is the Poincaré disk I think Anthony drew yesterday. And you eat out this piece from the collision. And there's my past light cone, so I see some part of it. And the projection of this perturbation on my past light cone just looks like a disk. That is a consequence directly just of the symmetry of the space-time and causality. Causality because the collision only affects a finite piece of the surface of light scattering. And because of the stretching of inflation, there's a completely generic signature. So the projection of this onto my past light cone will give me a fluctuation in the temperature that is some template plus the standard fluctuations in lambda CDM, where that template looks something like this. It's actually a temperature that just falls like the cosine of the angle from the center of the collision. It's a really similar thing. Okay, so that's the prediction. Okay, that's going from the Lagrangian to the thing that I see on the sky. So if it was actually on the sky, it might look something like that. So this is the real, you know, simulation of the CMB sky, where here we talked about this mask, right? So if I just take all the parts that are contaminated by the galaxy and I get rid of them, that's the gray. And then this signal is buried, right? It's buried because there are those CMB fluctuations. It's also buried because the instrument has some noise, and the instrument actually smears the signal out because it's looking at the CMB through some window. It doesn't have infinite precision. So if you include all those effects, you might get something like this. If it was like that, we'd just look at the CMB and say, wow, that's a bubble collision, great. But we don't look at the CMB and see that, so we need to be a little bit more clever. We'll get there in a second. So first let's ask, well, should I care about this? Like, how many of these would I expect to be in the CMB in the first place? Do I expect any to be there? So here again is this Penrose diagram for a single bubble, and it's got this ice cream cone shape, which Anthony explained yesterday, and Lenny likes to call hats. So in this bubble, here is constant Robertson-Walker time. Here's where the bubble nucleated, and this is the wall. So here's the beginning of inflation, and if I look at this potential, that, say, is here. And then I have slow roll. If I look at the potential, it's here. And then I have reheating, and here I am today. So we're somewhere in that universe, right? Let's say we're here. So I can look at my past light cone, and, you know, I go down here, and eventually I'd see the CMB. And then if I could detect gravitational waves from the early universe, I could see stuff from down here. And then I get outside my bubble, okay? So I can see in my past. In my past is outside the bubble. I don't know if I can see there yet, but it's in my past. And now we have to put a few conditions. So first of all, we need to avoid Olber's paradox. Okay, so if I had bubbles forming arbitrarily far in the past, I would have already been hit by an infinite number of bubbles. Just like if the universe was infinitely old and could produce stars forever, then there would be an infinite number of stars in my sky, and the night sky would just be bright. That's Olber's paradox. So to avoid a version of Olber's paradox, I have to say there are no bubbles before some time. And that choice is arbitrary. Turns out it doesn't matter what choice you make in the end, so it's just, for now, it's this. And I'm a bubble, and I came from this outside space. And for that to be true, nothing could have happened in here. Because if something happened in here, I'd be a bubble inside a bubble. I wouldn't have come from this space. So just by definition, if this thing is here, nothing could have happened there. And so what that means is that anything that can happen in here, after the time that I say there's nothing, and outside of this time, here, outside of this area here, because I'm not a bubble in a bubble, anything that happens in here, in principle, I could see. And so if I make bubbles at some rate, so if I make them with some probability per unit time, per unit volume, then the total number that I should expect to be able to, in principle, observe is basically the 4 volume of this patch here. So that's the region that I can harvest for other bubbles to align it with. And if that number is bigger than 1, then I predict, well, then there should be some in my past. If the theory predicts that that n is bigger than 1, then the prediction is there should be something to see. Okay, so I can be a little bit more careful, and I can ask, well, what if I only ask for collisions who intersect the part of the surface of last scattering that I can see and give me those nice disks? And that number is given by this here. So let's unpack that for a second. So there are some scales in here. So there's the scale of inflation outside the bubble, that's HF. There's the scale of inflation inside the bubble, that's HI. And then there's the current observed component of the energy density and curvature. And I should have chosen K, it's unfortunate that I chose C. Okay, and then lambda, this is the probability per unit volume per unit time that I can see something. So that's typically a small number. That was what I said about this generic business. So generically, that's an exponentially suppressed thing. And then I have this ratio here. That's free. That could be big. Maybe the energy density outside the bubble is much bigger than the energy density inside. And finally, I have this. That's the present day observed curvature. And that we know to be small, so that's a number less than about 0.01 at the moment, maybe a little bit more than that. So this is a small number, this is a small number. If I want n to be bigger than 1, I need that hierarchy. So that's a price of entry. So now we know what we need to require of our theory to have some predicted signature. And for the rest of the talk, we're just going to assume that that happens, so that there's something interesting to look for. Yeah.
If it's really true that the universe is flat, or at least the part we see is flat, omega c is zero, that means this can't happen.
Yep, that's right. So
so you're really depending on the uncertainty of omega c, or omega k, as you called it earlier?
Yep, that's right. Price of entry. So if it's less than 10 to the minus 5, we'll never know, right? Because then we wouldn't be able to distinguish curvature from a big density fluctuation. So for us to know that the universe is open, I am relying on detecting curvature sometime between 10 to the minus 5 and 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 2, which is the current window that's left to be uncertain.
And the bubble collision would then tell you that the global universe outside of our horizon is openly curved, for example.
If there was a bubble collision unambiguous and I didn't also detect curvature, then maybe I could make that extrapolation. If there was a bubble collision that I detected unambiguously and I also detect curvature, that's a much stronger piece of evidence. And, okay, so I can ask of these collisions, of that total number, you know, like what size disks on my C of B do they actually correspond to? And you can work that out. And they follow a probability distribution that's basically the sine of the size, sine of the angular radius. So the most likely thing is something that is as big as half the sky. That's right here in the middle. So that's the prediction from here. Okay.
So we have these hot and cold spots at the anomalies in the Planck data. They don't look like circles. But could you interpret them possibly as a whole bunch of large bubble collisions?
Why don't you wait for that later? Okay, so that's sort of full circle. You know, what are the predictions for a single bubble, and then what's the statistics? How many do I expect, and what sizes should they have, etc. So the model is, I start with this potential. That gives rise to eternal inflation. That gives rise to an ensemble of possible CMB skies. And there's a generic signature, so there's that profile for each of these collisions. And then the model can be characterized. So there's how many do I expect to see, what are the parameters that I need to describe each one, and how many of each type do I expect to find. That's really the model, that's the prediction, this set of things right here. So what would it look like? Okay, if they were totally obvious in the CMB, here's one example. So I have all these different collisions, they take different sizes, and that's just one realization. Of course, now, one thing I should mention is that this is probably very unlikely from a theory standpoint. Yeah. I've got these really big and really small numbers in that prediction for n, so I probably expect zero or infinity. And this is like 5. But 5 is easier to look for than 0 and infinity, so we're actually kind of restricting ourselves. Okay, but here's really what we see. really they're buried. They're buried in the primary CMB, they're buried in the instrumental noise. So I want to know, you know, like, here's what I have, it's nothing obvious. Can I say, does the data prefer a theory with collisions or not? So how would I go about doing that? Well, we already know that lambda CDM is really good at explaining the power spectrum, and it's even better than this plot. So how do we decide if there are anomalies? Let's kind of return to this question of anomalies. Well, one way is to use frequentist statistics. Frequentists would say, well, how discrepant is the data really, assuming the null hypothesis, that there's no anomaly there? And then there's the Bayesian, which I would fall into that camp, and you'll hear all about for this the talk, and I'll ignore all the frequentist crap, which is to ask, does one model fit the data better than another? That's, as I've loaded the question, obviously a better question to ask if I want to know if the CMB data fits theory with bubble collisions in lambda CDM better than lambda CDM. Okay, so what do we do with Bayesians? Bayesians. I always say Bayesian. I don't know if it's Bayes or Bayes, but whatever. So anyway, the goal, what we want, is the probability of a model with a certain set of parameters given the data. And you can think of that roughly like, how should I bet? Do I believe in this theory or not? How much money do I want to put on it? This will tell you. So here's Bayes' theorem. It says that the probability of the model and with some parameters given the data, which is what I want, is the prior probability for these different parameters to take different values times this guy, which we introduced before. That's the likelihood. That's the probability of the data given the model and the parameters. You can operationally think of this as, you know, let's say I do a whole bunch of simulations of data. How many times do I get, you know, what I see if I stick in a given model with given parameters? And then this is something called the evidence. So here's the probability of the data given the model. Okay, so here's these objects, that's the prior, I normalize that to 1 usually, this is the likelihood, and the evidence, you can think it's like the model averaged likelihood. So I average over all the possible values that these parameters can take, weighted by the prior. That's just some normalization to get something over here that's also normalized. Yeah?
Isn't the thing on the right of that equation the probability of these are given the data from the model?
Where?
It's a prior. He's asking about P of theta.
But you say to Bayes' theorem, and it looks to me like on the left you should have probability of these are given data from the model.
No, I think that's what I want.
Then that's not Bayes' theorem.
What?
Everything on each conditional block can only be on one side of the conditional block. Like if model comma theta is A and data is B, then model comma theta is sort of together, it stays together and it flips on the other side, which one
I
said.
I think it's... I think I see your point, but I think it doesn't matter so much. So just get rid of model and put data in there. Put model wherever you like. But you're right, we're conditioning on it being a certain model. Okay, so the likelihood is used to quantify how consistent data is with a set of model parameters, right? So this is usually what we do to get things like that. The exclusion plot, say, in the quant paper, WMAT paper. This one is from WMAT. But it doesn't tell us how we should rank competing theories trying to describe the same data. That's the other thing. So we can do something else. If we want to really know how do we rank competing theories, then we need to apply a Bayes' theorem at the level of models. So this is why I wanted to put models on that side. So I want to know what the probability of different models are given the data. And I can get that if I have a prior over the different models, and I can compute this evidence, the probability of the data given a specific model. And now I normalize that by this weird guy here, probability of the data. So let's say I have a model that fits the data pretty well. You know, I want to know, should I introduce a more complicated model that might fit it even better? And you can decide that by looking at the evidence ratio. So the thing I want, probability of model 1 given the data over probability of some other model given the data, is given by this. That's just from Bayes theorem. And, you know, maybe you have some preference here, maybe you don't. If I don't have any preference, then this is just given by the ratio of the likelihoods. And that's something that I can compute. Now, another thing to note is that the evidence sort of naturally implements Occam's razor. Because the simpler model, well, according to Occam's razor, should be favored. That's not because, just a statement. And the way that this happens is that there's a tension between the volume of parameter space and the goodness of fit. So how do I get the probability of the data given the model, this model likelihood? I integrate over all the possible values the parameters could have taken, right? So if I have more parameters and I don't get an extraordinarily better fit, then that's going to be diluted over this huge volume of parameter space. So you sort of there's a mathematical implementation of Occam's razor. So let's come back to this, which Joel had in his talk. You know, like, well, how do we decide? Is that significant? You know, are Stephen Hawking's in the CMB significant? How would we do that? So let's say model 1 is lambda CDM, and model 2 is that the CMB is really Stephen Hawking's creation. He's God, and he signed this copy. Well, we would evaluate this evidence ratio, right, between these two models. Now let's look at the different pieces. Okay, so when we say that you know, that's in the data and it's anomalous, right? What we're saying is that the likelihood that we calculate here is small. So if I had a model where Stephen Hawking signed the copy, then that likelihood would be bigger, right? But of course, this is ridiculous because my model priors, so here you see the priors are all important. It's not enough just to look at the ratio of likelihoods. The priors also count. In the prior for model 2, that Stephen Hawking is God. Well, I don't know who you are, but you know, maybe that's kind of low. So the reason we reject this, I mean, the reason we reject model 2 is really all about the prior. So you gotta be careful. Anyway, so that's just an illustration. So what do we do? What we want, what anyone would want, who's a Bayesian, we want to compare these two models. What are the two models? One of them is lambda CDM, and the other one is lambda CDM with a whole bunch of bubbles in it. And there's a sort of convenient theory label. So what do I want to call model? Models I'm going to distinguish by the number of these bubbles that are predicted to be in the CMB. Different models will predict different numbers. Okay, and I have these probability distributions that tell me for the, you know, different parameters what that should be. So this is a direct analogy. This is what I was calling models. And theta on the previous slides will just be all the properties each individual collision could have. So it's also nice because lambda CDM, one model I'm trying to compare with, is just specified by none. Okay, so that's a good model label. So there's a technicality, which is that this theory label is really the number of things that I expect to detect, and not necessarily the total number that there might be. Just forget about it for now, but you can ask about that later. Okay, so I start with the CMB, and I want to calculate this this probability of the posterior probability of this number given the data. So maybe I get a plot that looks something like this. Okay, so if it looked like that, the black line, that would mean there's no detection, right? It peaks around zero. That is, the posterior probability is largest for lambda CDM. Probability of none is bigger than probability of any other number. But if it was one of these guys, then that would mean that I would get a detection. The posterior around some number is bigger than zero. Unfortunately, that's hard. So to calculate that, what I really need is I need to test for an arbitrary number of these templates at arbitrary positions on the sky with arbitrary shape, size, and amplitude as long as it lies in this prior, right? And that's totally impossible. So you can't do that. So we need to come up with some way to approximate that thing that we want. And here's the solution. So you do it in two steps. First, you try and identify the parts of the sky that might be interesting. So you find Stephen Hawking's initials, if that's your template, right? You have something that does that. And then what we're going to do is we're going to find some approximation to that probability by integrating over only the regions of parameter space that probably contribute to that posterior probability. And we're going to say that the other contributions are zero. Schematically, that's what you do. So in practice, we first need to find these candidates. So the way that we do that is we filter the CMB in such a way that we'll pick them out. Just one second. And then, after that, we're going to judge the significance of these features based on our expectations for these different models. And, you know, we can calibrate that by using simulations that don't contain collisions to make sure that we're not biasing ourselves, so that it's really a blind search.
So in filtering the parameter space, is it effectively like saying, I'm just going to ignore a really small polar coordinate signature, for example, I'm going to look for the long wavelength ones, those kind of things?
No, that's in the prior. So here, what we're really doing, let me just give you a visual illustration. So somewhere in there, there's a bubble collision that I simulated. It's there to pick it out by eye. And so what you can do is you can apply sort of scale-dependent filters known as wavelets. So here is features at some scale. Here's features at another scale. Here's features at another scale, and here are features on the scale of where that collision that I stuck in by hand. And you can see that this filter just picks it out, right? There's a huge amplitude response there. So now what I want to do is I just want to cut that part of the data out. Just that part that contains this candidate that I think is there. Okay, so you know, what do we do in practice? There's some calibrated thresholding that we calculate, and we keep everything that is above a certain range, and we're sort of sensitive to some range of amplitudes. If they're too small amplitude, we'll never see them, so we wouldn't pick them out. Okay, so let's say I found one. So what I can do is I can calculate the evidence ratio just for that little patch of data. Okay, so I can ask, how much better does do you describe the data in that patch by adding just one template? That's not the whole answer, that's just a partial answer. And so, you know, here it is, that's just, you know, integrate over the model parameters, this likelihood, and then divide that by the likelihood for the theory with no collisions, that's just lambda c. So, you know, in detail, what does that contain? Well, this contains cosmic variance, it contains all this garbage like the window of the experiment, it contains the noise, all that stuff is built in there when I calculate that probability. And you have to assume some prior, so I guess it's not that important, but there's some motivated set of priors. And so you do that for each of the candidates, and you can derive this, you know, like I promise this is the ugliest equation you'll see during this 4 weeks or whatever, but you derive this incredibly ugly expression, which is an approximation to this thing you want, which is this posterior probability, given all of these different individual weightings of how much better do you fit the data for these different pieces. So what do you get? So here's the WMAP data. Here is a map of the candidates in that data set. So they're labeled down here. These are the patches of the data that we actually process. And here's the answer. So lambda CDM seems to work pretty well. And you can constrain how many there could be, you know, just from the theory. So if the theory predicts that there's any more than 1.6, then I can rule that out at 68% confidence. That's not consistent with what we see. So that's pretty cool. That's a test. That's a test of eternal inflation. It failed the test, but it's a test nevertheless. You can test it. So what's next? What else can you do? Well, you can check for signals in other data sets that might help you. So for example, it's predicted that there's a corresponding polarization signal in the CMB. It looks kind of like a ring. I'm pretty skeptical about that personally, because Planck resolution with noise with that signal and it looks like this. So it's really low signal to noise. So I don't know how much that's going to help. maybe if you had something that was marginally significant and this would push it over the edge, but we don't even have that. So that might help, it might not. I don't think it will. So another thing that you can do is to ask, well, what have we actually constrained? What does that tell us about the underlying theory? And so to answer that question, you kind of need to in detail understand this logical chain. You need to go from the theory to the collision to the prediction for what we see. And so that's kind of like inflation, but the black box that I put the prediction through is just more complicated. So there's different potentials, they make different predictions for the data. And I want to know, you know, by doing this a whole bunch of times, kind of like a Markov chain, what do we get? What can we constrain? That's kind of cool, actually, because I think this is the first connection, really, between numerical relativity and observational cosmology. So that's a nice interface between things. I guess that's all I had. So yeah. Thanks. This has been nice.
So this result that you actually have an upper limit on the number of bubble collisions, it's not been published.
Oh yeah, it's been published.
Based on that?
Yeah.
There hasn't been any similar thing for Planck, though.
There will be in a few months.
Once we finish. And the results are going to be similar?
Yeah, they're going to be very similar. The reason is that the prior is weighted at these collisions at really large scales.
Right.
So Planck doesn't help with that. So you're probably not going to see much. Incidentally, you can use these same methods to look for other stuff in the CMB. So we have a paper that looks for cosmic textures. And those, in fact, you'll do much better with Planck data because they're
small scales.
The prior is weighted towards really small things. So we'll see what happens with that. We'll get a better constraint for them.
And of course, there's other geometric non-Gaussianity strings and things like that.
Yeah, so strings are a little bit harder. We haven't figured out how exactly to directly apply these methods to cosmic strings, but that's another thing you could try.
So I asked earlier about the CMB temperature anomalies.
Yeah.
Not both collisions could play any role in that?
I don't think so. Maybe. I'm sure we could cook up some model where they do. But I also don't really think that those anomalies, personally, are very significant. It's 2, 3 sigma. And that's like a posteriori, meaning you don't have a model for it. You're just looking for weird crap in the data. So maybe if you had a really compelling model, you could convince yourself that was really there. But outside of that, yeah. There's also reasons to think that at least this hemispherical power asymmetry that Joel mentioned is not really there. So their WMAP has a number of groups. And this is all secondhand information, by the way. I'm not in the collaboration or anything. But secondhand information. So there's a paper dedicated to anomalies that was written by some group of people and analyzed by some group of people. Then there's another paper that actually tries to infer our proper motion with respect to the CMB by looking at these power multiples. So you're gonna, if we're moving with respect to the CMB, you're gonna screw it up, right? So just from the Lorentz transformation, and that will induce a power asymmetry. So they find a power asymmetry that's completely consistent with what we think our problem velocity is with respect to the CMB, and these other guys find something that's like vastly larger. So you got two groups, they're both, you know, composed of extremely intelligent people doing extremely good analyses, and they get different answers. So I tend to believe the one that is consistent with our proper motion with respect to the CMB, because that requires me to assume much less speculative physics. So my bet's on that.
So the anomaly could be sort of a residual dipole?
It could just be a statistical fluke. They perform a different analysis, and there's some, they just got a different answer because of some statistical fluke.
The reason I was asking is because you showed a plot where the probability for both collisions was modeled to be the largest collisions would be the ones that would be the most likely.
Right.
And then, we're talking about hemispherical size things.
Yep. So I'm sure you can cook up a model where that happens, and then we'd be arguing, probably we'd be arguing about priors, because I think the significance you get just from the data would come in just be a sort of marginally significant thing, 2-3 sigma. So I don't know. Yeah.
Can you say a bit more about how the priors are assigned? Because you can get pretty much any conditional probability you like by a suitable assignment of priors.
Yeah, good. So the only thing that's really varying, well, there's two things that are varying. There's sort of the kinematics of this collision. So if we fix the fact that we exist, then these other bubbles could have nucleated from different places at different times, and the center of mass energy will be different. And you can put a measure on that by just saying that bubbles are equally likely to form from each, you know, parcel of volume. And then just count up the number of volume, the amount of volume that gives you one answer versus another, and then you naturally will get a probability distribution. So that's where the prior, for example, on the sizes comes from. You just look at some parcel of 4 volume, ask how big of a size collision does it map onto on my sky, and how much volume gives me that same size.
Because you're smuggling in a prior there, which assigns reasonably high probability to prior probability to the occurrence of bubbles.
Sure.
So in what sense is that a more reasonable assumption than assigning a reasonably high prior to Steve Hawking?
Yeah, it's not. You need to put that in there.
Okay.
So multiply that answer by whatever prior you want.
Yeah, sure.
Just be clear about what your priors are. And then that's fine.
So you got a bound on the number of collisions, and it seemed like fairly consistent. There was a collision. What's the, on the picture, is there, can you point to the one that's sort of most probable, the signature that looks most like a collision?
Yeah, we can speculate on that. That's kind of fun.
Yeah.
So let's look at these things. So I think number 3, that's the cold spot, the famous cold spot. That's also weird from a sort of a posteriori perspective, meaning that you'd have to generate like 1,000 or 10,000 random realizations of the CMB before you got a spot that was that cold and that big.
Anywhere in the sky?
Anywhere on the sky, do you get it? The chance that you get it there is 0. You have to do that an infinite number of times. So that's one of the things that's significant, and I think it's just significant because if I picked any template, it would fit the data a little bit better there, because it's a little bit inconsistent with what I'd expect from line to CDM. Some of these other ones, like I think number 2 and number 6, number 4, those are the most significant ones. Now, another kind of interesting thing, which is a little bit related to this hemispherical power asymmetry, although it's not exactly consistent because the scales are different. All the significant stuff is in the southern galactic hemisphere, just sort of by accident. So those are the most discrepant spots with respect to lambda CDM. And that might have something to do with the story, but I don't know. So you could play games with that, but again, the point is that when I sew all of these things together into that master probability, it's still, you know, the evidence from each of these individual little pieces of information is still not enough to make you favor the theory that they're actually bubble collisions. So it's not that significant.
It seems like if there's at least one bubble collision, then that slightly perturbs your assumptions of homogeneity and isotropy for FW versus TW. Sort of a preferred axis in the direction of the collision. Would it have any other downstream effects on galaxies and things like that other than CMB?
So I'll answer your question first, but it actually motivates another interesting question which has an interesting answer. So you'd expect there to be some, you know, imprint on large scale structure, galaxies and whatnot. People have estimated the size, and it's small and not observable. It probably could be done better, and then you'd get a more precise correlation, because now, you know, we know more about what the space-time is like, basically. So, yeah, that can be done. Now, the interesting question you could have asked is there a preferred frame she started with? And the answer is yes. The reason that there's a preferred frame actually goes all the way back here. So I said, this surface is special. Okay, now depending on where I am inside the bubble, I'm either at rest with respect to that surface or I'm moving with respect to that surface. Okay? So there is a preferred frame where this surface is at rest. And so now I can ask things like, well, what could that do? What imprint would that preferred frame have? And the imprint that it has is that, well, if I mirrored this diagram, and I'm not in the center of the bubble, then I'll see more collisions coming from one side than the other, because there's going to be more four volume in my past on one side than on the other. So the distribution of bubble collisions is intrinsically asymmetric. And it's asymmetric because of this initial condition surface. Now the reason I didn't talk about that at all is that, let's say I pushed myself all the way out here, where all of my four volume basically is on one side and none on the other. It turns out that all of those collisions that I get from all of that four volume on this one side are much, much larger than the part of the surface of last scattering that I see. So to me, they just like a shift in the background, right? So I don't really see any intrinsic anisotropy from those. It's hard for me to count them because, well, they just look like a readjustment of the background, so I don't know if I could count them. It looks just like the background. So that was noticed by Guth, Garriga, and Valenkin. That's called the persistence of memory. And you kind of forget about it because of this fact that most of those collisions are just way bigger than the part of the last scattering you see. Now, a puzzle is there's still an infinite number of them. Or can there be an infinite number of them? Probably not, actually, because each of these collisions back reacts on the geometry. So if there were an infinite number of them, you wouldn't have inflation. You wouldn't be here. So there's probably some regulation of that number. It's probably not actually infinite. But anyway, that's just some other thoughts on a different question, which is an interesting one.
Is there any connection, though, to the tenuous, possible bubble collisions all being in one hemisphere?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe you have some collision that prevented other collisions from happening in that part of the sky. Something like that. I don't know.
Would this violate cosmic Lorentz invariance?
What is cosmic Lorentz invariance?
Well, I guess having a preferred frame.
Yeah, there is a preferred frame. It does. It violated de Sitter symmetry because you put that initial condition surface there.
But an actual state of matter would always have to violate symmetry. Not be symmetric. The laws of motion are still in there.
Yeah, that's right. So now we're going to come back to this question, the much simpler one of inflationary fluctuations, and how do I go from a homogeneous state to an inhomogeneous state quantum mechanically? What does that mean?
How much freedom do you have to accept that initial condition surface that gives you the frame?
All the freedom in the world. It could be whatever you want.
But no matter where you put it, you'll get a preferred frame.
Yep. Now, it turns out the prediction that I made doesn't matter for this choice. Because if I assume I'm one of these observers over here, all of the four volume is in that little armpit, which doesn't care about this initial condition surface or how I set it up. Let's go.